To live by one's wits required the colonists to do two things. One was to break the rigid rules prescribed by mercantilism, and the other was to get away from the supervision of the colonial authorities. Both requirements were met by the natives engaging in contraband trade with foreigners and by moving into the rural interior of the island. All the natives consisted of the poor whites of European background and the poor free blacks who both encountered the few remaining Indians living in the interior. The intermingling and intermarrying of these groups generation after generation gave rise to the criollo or native island population, which was no longer Spanish, African, or Indian, but Puerto Rican. By the mid-18th century, it was evident there was a unique native personality as opposed to that of the Europeans. Alejandro O'Reilly, investigating the contraband situation for King Charles III, noted this in his report. He describes the natives as living a simple and easy life with a minimum of wants, free of racial tensions, and given to the practice of rustic social equality unmatched in the neighboring non-Hispanic islands. Fray Iñigo Abad La Sierra, the writer of the island's first history, which was published in 1789, also describes this native rustic population. His history presents Puerto Ricans as a people with distinct behavioral patterns permeating all segments of the population. The good monks or the jíbaro, or country folk, as the symbol of fortitude, with a reluctance to become part of the impersonal institutional framework of the colonial world. The jíbaro's love for the island was part of his traditional way of life. It was the jíbaro who helped save San Juan from the British attack under Sir Ralph Abercrombie in 1797. Coming down from the mountains, they joined in the fight to save their island from foreigners. It was then that a national conscience was being born. In the mid-18th century, Charles III, one of the few enlightened kings regarding colonial policy, enacted a series of reforms to break away from the rigid mercantilism of the past. Unfortunately, their impact was all but effective, since they were enacted upon too late, still mostly restrictive and too few at a time. By the time he declared a free trade policy in 1788, he died, and his inept son, Charles IV, reversed all that had been accomplished. The natives continued to engage in contraband, and in so doing, were declaring an economic independence that one day would lead to a cry for national independence.